What is your question?
Last night, we were talking with a non-Ahmadi in my uncle's house. He said it's not my duty to preach, and I'm a simple Muslim, and I don't want to, unless I need to do so. So I quoted the verse, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنَ قَالَ مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And he said, there is no mention of faith in this sequence, but the amal-e saleh and the call to the invitation to the God. And why the amal-e saleh is not iman is not mentioned? How can one become a Muslim without iman?
No one can't.
So in that verse,
in the sense truly speaking. But otherwise, professional, as far as the profession goes, one can become a Muslim without having any iman. That is the right to call himself a Muslim, without having any iman. This is what the Holy Quran tells us. There were people from among the Bedouins who are mentioned in the Holy Quran as saying that they have believed. The Holy Prophet of Islam is told to address them and tell them that you have not believed, because the faith has not even peeped into your hearts, it has not entered your hearts. So you can still say yourself Muslim, but do not say, call yourself a Mu'min, because you are not Mu'min. So that indicates that there could be some mu'mineen, some non-believers who may profess Islam, and this right of profession of Islam will not be taken from them by anyone. So there could be Muslims without faith, and they can be termed as munafiqeen as well. But truly speaking, it's impossible for a Muslim to be without faith. Dr. Sahib.
Assalamu alaikum. As Salim has just mentioned, sir, that he was talking to one of our relatives who is non-Ahmadi Muslim. It was a very interesting thing to watch, sir. That
were you there?
I was there.
All
sir,
the time?
At my
yes.
home.
Yes.
I didn't, as a matter of fact, indulge too much, because he had dinner at our
I
home.
I see, so quite.
He, as a matter of fact, indirectly in the end said, well, because I had dinner with you, that's why you are preaching me here.
Rubbing it in.
So I avoided that personally. Right. But Salim, who is a young boy, and my own son Mahmood, who is just 14,
yes.
They both took him on, and I know that he has done PhD in Islamiyat. And many times he was just answerless. And in the end, when he didn't have any answer, he said, oh well, you are young boys, you have yet to learn a lot. So it was really a very interesting
yes.
experience.
And do you think if you invite him again, he would come?
I hope so.
Huh?
Well, probably, like, if he knew that we would take him
if
on.
Salim is there in your house,
probably
would
not.
He come again?
Probably not. But
probably not. So you have lost the purpose of preaching.
No, sir.
Because people should be addressed in a manner
yes, sir.
To win their hearts, not to be defeated.
Again, I can't say, sir, what was his...
if he has lost his interest, yes. even in your dinner...
He seemed to be very adamant.
Also, to choose a different person. Why to waste your precious time on such people? Moreover, they are arrogant. The more they think they have learned, the more arrogant and haughty they become. And this remark shows that he is a vain person.
Sir.
Instead of accepting his defeat in good grace,
yes,
he is transferring his defeat to the opposite party, to the conqueror.
Sir.
So such people should be left alone. Why should he waste his precious time on these people? Find ordinary, normal people
At the same time, with respect...
With the correct balance of mind, that's highly important. Knowledge or lack of knowledge of religion is not important in conversation about religion. The frame of mind one has, the attitude, the inner nobility, that is highly important. If one has a balanced mind, then even if he is highly qualified, he would begin to see where he is at wrong. Yes. But if he is a mullah in character, then it's impossible to converse with him.
Sir, respectfully, may I mention here that we know that Hazrat Umar was very staunch opposition to Islam, and God Almighty changed his mind in just one moment.
Because his frame of mind was correct. Obviously.
Correct. Yes. Thank you, sir. Yes. So in that discussion, he mentioned one thing. We were discussing this, and as I said, I didn't take a very active part in there. These boys were taking active role. He was not aware of the fact that there are at least 73 sects or 72 sects. And we told him at a very...
Again, that's very, very strange denial of knowledge.
Yes, sir.
Because having done PhD in Islamiyat,
yes, sir,
he never came across that tradition about 72 sects.
I
mean, apparently it's unbelievable.
That's right, sir.
So we can...
Is it, sir, available somewhere, the list of all the sects in Islam?
Yes.
Could it be...
It is Al-Milal wa-Nihl. Kiski kitab hai ye Milal wa-Nihl? Ibn Hayyan? Ibn Hayyan ki album. Anyway, Al-Milal wa-Nihl is a famous book.
Right,
and it mentions the divisions of Muslim world, Muslim people into 72 sects.
Right, sir.
And but the point is that again in history this thing has been going on changing.
Sir.
At each juncture of history you would find a certain people, certain number of sects which may not be present at another juncture in time. Some may have disappeared and some new ones may have entered. So it's a constant process, like you can't keep count sheep.
Right.
You cannot count sects in historic perspective. So, but you can say this is a book written from so many years ago,
right,
in which you find that the number was about reached.
Right.
So there might have been some sects which later on became extinct, and a few might have been added to the list, so this remained generally in the vicinity of 72.
Thank you, sir.
Ah, oh, that is quite... Oh, the headlines came, yes, were published. Just a minute, please. Ghulam Muhammad Sahib, Khokhar.
It was correct that it said...
Come forward, please, and speak.
Spoils of war.
Yes.
In fall that means, but do they mean the spoils on the battlefield or spoils from anywhere from the area?
Which, what do you mean by anywhere?
Anywhere. Because you see, what I hear, you see, that even women used to be in fall, bundles of cloth used to be in fall, so many other items which conceivably could not have been on the battlefield, they were used to be in fall, and they were used
on
to
the
be...
battlefield. Nobody said spoils of battlefield. I said spoils of war.
Exactly, sir.
And war is a different thing and battlefield is a different thing.
Yes.
Now what do you mean by battlefield and what do you understand by the word war? Please explain this and then we will come to an understanding.
Battlefield where the battle is fought.
And what is a war?
War, a country at war. It's the whole country is at war.
And what is the difference between battle and war?
Battle and war, you see, battle is fought at one place, whereas the whole country could be at war.
Pardon?
Battle is fought at one place, whereas war is, the whole country is at war, you see, the nation is
no,
at war.
The difference, battle is fought at one place,
yes.
Every battle in a war is fought at one place,
yes.
at some place?
Yes.
So there is not a difference.